Three, two, one.
Yippee-ki-yay, mother...
Welcome to the party, pal!
Welcome to another edition of Yippee-ki-yay, Mother Podcast. What's going on, Mother Podcasters?
Hey!
Hello.
Hey!
What's happening? John, why are you doing that?
John, what is the law?
What is the law? Okay, so tonight we're going to review and talk about two classic films remake.
Can you repeat that line that you just said?
Classic films.
The remakes of a classic?
Is that remakes of a classic.
Just okay, because I thought
two,
you said
two films
two
that are the same.
Classic films. Is what
the Island of Dr. Moreau, brought to you by Drew.
That's right.
Then we will do a spin. We have three left on the wheel. We're getting closer to the end of this remake.
I hope it's Beauty and the Beast. That's all I hope.
Yeah, I hope so too. I'll take that week off. And then we'll do another round, a quick round, a flash round of what you watch. I don't know why I keep saying flash round because it doesn't change
okay.
anything.
Ralph, but... I just want to say because on this particular show that we do, the 85 people who watch generally watch the first like 25 seconds. So I'm going to say it now. Please subscribe, hit the notification button, and smash that like button. Okay, go ahead.
Is that true? They don't get through 10 minutes on this show?
No, they do not.
Wow.
They do not.
I guess.
But we have twice as many movies here.
I know. No kidding.
I don't know, but one of my Indian commenters commented on something I talked about 25 minutes in. They were very upset at me. So I think that I think some of them are watching.
Of the remakes?
Yeah, I think so.
Not the Indian films. It was
no.
On the remakes.
One of these. So,
okay.
Yeah. Okay, right. Drew, go.
So for remakes, I decided to bring two films. They're both adaptations of the novel The Island of Dr. Moreau by H.G. Wells from the late 19th century, which is about a man who... leaves society so he can go and do science, like putting animals and humans together. That's the basic
play
premise of the story. Well, we'll get into that.
Yeah.
So there are many adaptations of this story and many riffs on this story, and there are relationships between this story and other stories I think you could draw. There's a grand tradition of people making things out of other things that are alive or making other people. So it's, you know, it's in the world of Frankenstein and Jurassic Park and all these other things. There's no question though, in the way that the story is told, Dr. Moreau is a villain. He's evil. He's doing something wrong. It's not like, some of the characters, where I don't think you could argue that, I'm totally blanking on his name, but the man behind Jurassic Park in the book, he's a villain, but in the movie he's John Attenborough. So he can't be evil.
Yeah, he's but too cute.
John Hamm.
We're going to talk about two movie adaptations. There is one that's behind John. It's not playing right now. It's just an image from it called Island of the Lost Souls. That is an adaptation from the early 30s.
I couldn't find that. I couldn't. Where do you go?
Yeah, I've never seen that. It's not streaming anywhere.
Oh my god! It's on Criterion. It's on TCM.
Are you sure it's on Criterion?
Well, it was. I don't know if it is now. I have it on. I have it on a disc.
Okay.
Well, next time let us know. I'd be happy to watch it because these movies I don't think are the best possible adaptations of the material, but in different ways. I had actually never seen the first one from 1977 that we'll talk about with Burt Lancaster as Dr. Moreau.
Yeah.
And I have seen the 1996 version many, many times, including in the theater when it came out. It's one of my favorite. It's one of my favorite bad movies in such specific ways. It's much more than, boy, that's so bad, I can't believe they made it. Like, there's just some horrendous, bizarre things in the movie and behind the scenes. But I'd like to talk about the first movie first, because I feel like the 1996 version will probably take up the bulk of our conversation. But the 1977 version, they all have a little bit different ways that they introduce the characters, but basically there's a man adrift at sea and he gets picked up and he ends up on the island, and the only people that are on this island, this mysterious island that is in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, are the shipwrecked man who in the 1977 version is Michael York, and what turns out to be Dr. Moreau, who's Burt Lancaster, and a mercenary that works for him named Montgomery, who played by an actor who was very good in that role, and I cannot remember his name.
Nigel.
And then there's also a human girl, or Davenport. Is she? And then everyone else that you meet is something that Dr. Moreau has made in his lab. And the way that he makes animals also changes over the different versions. In the book, it's pretty much about vivisection. And vivisection was a big controversial thing in public life in England at the time that it came out. In the 1977 version, it's almost kind of like magic, because it's about, I made a serum that I inject into an animal and it becomes human, but then it regresses back to an animal. So if I stick it in a human, will the human become an animal and then regress back to human? It's all bad science. I mean, it's literally experimenting on human beings or experimenting on animals for no good reason. And then in the most recent version, which we'll also talk about, hopefully not the last version that they ever try of this, it's set, you know, in our present day of 1996, and it's about genetic engineering and all these things that weren't part of our knowledge and scientific lexicon back when the story was written. So in the 1977 movie and the 1969 movie, essentially what happens is our main character finds out what's going on and is horrified, and the animals are abused and controlled. The animal, the beast men, are abused and controlled by Dr. Moreau, and they get tired of it. And that's pretty much what happens in both of the movies. I found the 1977 version, it was fine. I liked some of the performances a lot. It can't compete makeup-wise. It doesn't have anything super special. There are some interesting point of view shots in the beginning of the movie that give it some personality, but it really felt when I was watching it like, okay, I'm getting warmed up. So what did you guys think? And John, I suspect you have the most positive things to say. So
just if
you
want to start us off,
let's talk about the first one first, because I think the second one will take up a lot more of the conversation. As John, I know, is excited about that one.
Well, look, I okay, so two things. One, I love The Island of Lost Souls, which is the 1932 version. Charles Laughton is great as Dr. Moreau. The makeup for the time was good. It's a very creepy, eerie movie. It was before censorship, so there's some things that happen in it that couldn't happen later on. In fact, he wanted one of the animal men to rape a girl who came to the island. It was very, very creepy. The Lancaster one, okay, so... First of all, it seemed like a made-for-TV movie, even though it wasn't.
That's
it was
fair.
A theatrical movie. Mm-hmm. I give Burt Lancaster credit because he took what is normally played as a pure, evil, and a little bit nutty professor and grounded it in some kind of reality. A megalomaniac, but I give him credit for that. Michael York, the scene where he was in the prison cell after being injected and he's trying to retain his humanity, I thought that was really played well, but the
That's
movie overall,
scene.
It
yeah.
is, but the, and I didn't even mind, the makeup wasn't as good as the Brando version, but it wasn't bad. I the makeup didn't bother me. I just didn't think it was Barbara Carrera. I think that was her second film. She looked mm-hmm. beautiful in that movie mm-hmm. and that end shot, which they changed too. They added effects to it to give her cat eyes. That she
oh,
was
that that was a that was like added in post type
yeah.
of thing. I didn't know that.
Yeah, okay. So that wasn't because it didn't come across in the original version that she was reverting back. So that's why they did that. I just didn't think it was a very good version. I think compared to the Brando version, it's Citizen Kane of Dr. Moreau. But for me, The Island of Lost Souls is the only one that when I see this movie. Now I'm going to say one other thing. I was in a one-act play called The Crazy Mixed-Up Island of Dr. Moreau, and I was Montgomery.
Wow.
So ding, 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 Ralph. How come I never get a ding?
I lost the bell.
Oh, man. So
he's moving.
So I've got a kindred spirit.
I can't give you
play.
A rim shot.
Who did you play in the play?
I played Montgomery, Cockney. I played Cockney.
Yeah.
It was pretty. It was a one act. It was very funny. But if you watch The Island of Lost Souls and then watch these other two movies, they did a lot more with less, if you get what I'm saying. Because, you know, obviously each version gets more overblown with the makeup and the spectacle of it. And they didn't have that luxury, but it was shot beautifully in black and white. It was a real creepy set that they used. And like I said, Charles Laughton in this cream colored summer suit, who's a nut job, was just phenomenal in the movie. So if you ever get a chance, and if I can, Ralph, I can, if I can burn the, like, if I can somehow figure out a way to get the DVD to you guys, I'll be happy to do that.
And wasn't Bela Lugosi the lawsayer in that one?
He was the lawgiver.
Lawgiver.
Yeah. Not to walk on all fours.
But I mean, okay, I tried to watch that one. I couldn't find it. So great. If you can send me the DVD or somehow I could get something from you to see it, it'd be great. I watched both of these because, oh my God, I wish I had seen the 1996 version in the movie theater because I had never seen it. I had never seen it. And oh my God, did I miss something? Okay. So first of all, I'm going to say that. There's also the documentary that I watched based on the making of that film, which is as good, if not better, than the film.
No, way better than both these movies.
I don't know about that. I would have loved to have seen, what's his name? Stanley.
Richard Stanley.
Yeah. I would love to have seen his version. I love the fact that he was actually on the set in the mask of the dog, you know, in the thing. Just priceless stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, they had nothing good to say about any of the two main actors. Nobody had anything good to say about Brando or Val Kilmer. In that documentary. But having said that, there are scenes in that film that I just absolutely went apeshit over, like the ice bucket on Brando's head, the piano, the dual piano playing with that little guy and Brando.
Mini-Me.
And yeah, that's where Mini-Me came from, they think, you know, that whole Mini-Me idea.
Yeah.
So I watched that film and loved it. Now it's nuts and it's stupid, but it's just over the top great. I know that Brando didn't give a crap. He was telling just take the money and run, have fun with this, I'm gonna do whatever I want, don't worry about it, relax, you're way too, I just love that
you're
attitude that
paid,
he had.
You're getting paid.
Val was playing Chad. He was like being a total douchebag to everybody, you know, taking cigarettes and burning them on their long hair, whatever, just being an ass schmuck. But man, I loved it. So then I go and watch the other one.
Oh, you watched it in reverse order?
I did. I watched the 96, then I had 77. 96, by the way, is actually 100 years after the book was written, I think. It's literally 100 years.
I think that's right.
So there was that. Then I watched the other one. And not as good, I didn't think, but still fun. Michael York wearing the same shirt throughout the whole film, that was driving me crazy. Everybody knows I got hung up on that stuff.
When he wore the shirt.
But I did enjoy that take on it, and I enjoyed, there's some good shots. And John, you said it looked like a TV movie, which it did. It had that feel. But that shot at the end where the doctor's hanging in the fires behind him, I just thought that was and Michael York's spot. Right, wow. Michael York's scene where he's trying to remember things from his past so he doesn't turn into a complete animal, I just thought was really well done. What I took away from both films, and I this might be a British thing, because like Lord of the Flies has the same idea that when society breaks down and laws are gone, what's going to happen? And both these films take the approach that when the laws are gone, chaos happens. Chaos ensues. And I don't know if that's a British thing.
There is no freedom without the law.
Right.
That's one of the fundamentals of philosophy.
Yeah. Well,
no freedom without law.
So without law, what happens?
Chaos.
Chaos. And sort of you could take that analogy to religion too. Like if you're an atheist and you don't have the Ten Commandments, then all hell's going to break loose on earth.
I think somebody has to be there to drive you into chaos. And in both of the movies and in the book, you know, he's created these monsters, but they have agency. And so they, you know, when you discover, I don't have to hurt anymore because I can rip this thing out of my own flesh and then I can eat you, that's a pretty empowering experience for, you know, hyena swine and all this other stuff. So I think it fits that classic mold, and it's even worse than Lord of the Flies, because Lord of the Flies, they didn't plan on being there, and this is a world of pain that Dr. Moreau created because
right. I mean, it's
insane. Yeah.
It gave them something to,
and it's called the House of Pain.
In the 77, but in the 96 we didn't see anything.
It might
I don't remember seeing anything really experimental in the 96. Well,
the only thing you see, the only thing you see is when
no, that's the 77.
David Thewlis, which witnesses some kind of creature giving birth in the lab and being tended to by what turns out to be all the beastmen that are helping him. But all of the science in that is under a microscope and in, you know, injections and making embryos and stuff. The 1977 version is definitely more like, I'm hurting you. I'm giving you an injection and you are suffering. It's more painful to imagine the protagonist discovering that at that point, because
they took it out of the, you know, he had the House of Pain was where he dragged people when he wanted to punish them. Brando
it's
wore
where
that,
he did his science.
Where he did his transformation.
Well, and also he punished, you know, I'm going to drag you to the House of Pain.
Well,
and
then,
okay. Can I just say this? H.G. Wells, the writer.
Right.
We read that. We read that on the way to Ohio. And wow, what a guy. You know, he was known, and then we did a deep dive on H.G. Wells, Herbert George Wells. And he is from, biology. And, you know, when he was born in this age of science, he's known as the first beginning of a science mind.
Science fiction.
Science fiction, but also he is a scientist. He studied biology, chemistry in college. But what really drove him to his writing career was a broken leg when he was 10. So he started reading all these great big
Jules
scientists.
Verne.
Yes, all those guys. So basically, he was a few, and he's known as a futuristic,
He wrote the Time Machine, right?
He built a time machine.
Right.
Now he knew in his mind that there was some correlation between animals and humankind. You know what I mean? DNA proves that. I don't know how it works out in creation, but. He had.
I told you never to call me here. I told you never to call me here. All right. Yeah, I'll call you later. Sorry, guys.
Thank you, John. So basically, this is so hard because there's a point here between humans and animals. That is it. And if you go and try to make an animal. Human, you know, the first problem you have is morality. You know, where does morality and this difficulty with the animals on the island coming and having, you know, to try to be human is heartbreaking because animals may or may not exist with a soul. You know, we don't know these things. These are all mind in your mind. You know what kind
of Debbie, what did you think of the film?
I was just going to ask, did you like the films?
Yes, it was so mind provoking because it's how could somebody in the 1800s come up with this story? How? And it's
or
happening.
Like an invisible
man.
Could
clone. Invisible man, you can't see it coming, but he did. He had that vision, and when you see. When you
see the invisible man. Coming.
I never saw the invisible man. Couldn't see that coming.
Sean and Debbie, your internet's a little chunky, so just be aware that you guys
always
are chunking.
It could use a little science.
Yeah. I don't know if that's why the take sounded
technology
as long
really
as it took, because your internet's funky, but
that's very generous
and
of
I,
you.
Okay, so, let me add something. Debbie and I we watched both of these movies and we listened to the H.G. Wells book on the way and back. From Ohio over the weekend.
Did you listen to
the Richard Stanley version? Because there's a version where he reads the book.
Did you read The Island of Dr. Moreau, or did you read a book about H.G. Wells? Or did you listen to a book about H.G. Wells?
We listened to the entire novel.
Yeah.
22 chapters.
And it's fascinating. You know, it really is. The writing is just superb. And he does have a point, you know, with the... all his plans to.
Okay, we have to lay down a law here on the podcast now. The law.
Man shall not kill man.
No walking on all fours, and make your points quicker. Otherwise, I take you to the House of Pain, or I just mute you. One of the two. So
they're frozen right now.
Yeah, I know they're frozen. So I wanted to say one other thing about the 77 version.
They're frozen. Yeah.
No, the animal stunts.
Okay, look, can I comment on the movies?
Well, you could if your internet were working.
We're amazing.
Properly.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes.
If the internet's not working, honey.
Yeah, it's you look like a silent movie. A
little funky.
Okay.
At least it's in color.
All right, let me go
it
back.
Some good stuff.
You're gonna have some editing to do, I think.
Are you there?
I'm not touching it. I'm gonna let it go as it is.
Okay.
Okay, just like fine. Real science,
because nobody's watching this. Let like me, you said,
we
so
can
really,
Sean, well, we can hear you, Sean. So tell us what you think.
Okay, so the 70s version is.
All right, Sean, do this. Here's what you need to do. Just for now, shut your camera off. Go in there and shut the camera off.
I really liked.
Go ahead, Sean.
I wanted to say you made a point earlier about the animal stunts.
Yeah, in the 77 version.
Yeah, I mean, that scene where he's wrestling with that tiger. I am surprised that tiger just didn't kill that guy. You know, the tiger must have thought it was playing. And that was really frightening.
It wasn't just the tiger. When they start breaking into the jail and the lions are jumping on him and they're busting through doors, I mean, the stunts in that thing were crazy.
Well, you know what? Debbie made a point while we were watching the end of that movie. She's like, this is just like one of those Planet of the Apes movies.
Yeah.
And the guy directed one of the later not good Planet of the Apes movies. And I sort of had that feeling about this movie quite a bit. But the funny thing is, this movie is most, the 77 version is most like the book.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they all take departures. They all add a woman character.
Well, I think Lost Souls, I don't think the Panther Lady was in the book.
She was not.
Right. So the first movie made, which is the one behind John, is when they added the woman who changes to a cat or a panther or whatever. And they took that through all three films.
Right.
They kept that element through all three films.
Yeah. And I as a screenwriter, you kind of think that's a good idea. But it really wasn't needed in the book. I just want to say one thing about the book. You know, the book, and if you saw Lost Souls, the documentary about the 96 version, the movies all stop early. You know, it's sort of like Moreau's killed and the guy escapes. But in the book, he's on the, after Moreau is killed and the animals, you know, have killed him, it's 8 months before he leaves. And,
oh, wow.
And to me, that's the most poignant part of the book, as he's sort of like, he's trying to maintain control so that they don't kill him. And some of the animals are kind of loyal to him, but they all slowly revert. And it's sort of like his feelings, you know, because he's kind of repulsed by the animals. He kind of needs them, but they're slowly going back into animal life. And to me, that is, he's there alone on this island with these semi-intelligent beasts. And one thing he does at the end, it's like in the end of the 76, when Moreau is killed and the animal people think there is no law, he goes and says, Moreau has shed his body, but he is still here. He is looking down. He doesn't show the body like he does in this. And the narrator's like, the good thing was that they were kind of stupid, you know, the animals.
Yeah, right.
So he had like a lot of them believing that. And then when I'd say in the book, Montgomery is actually the most interesting character. You know, because he's like, doesn't want to be there. He's repulsed, but he's the one who cares the most about the animals, which leads to that ridiculous scene in 77 where he like pulls a gun on Moreau and tells him to release the guy. And, you know, but, you know, which did not happen in the book. Montgomery is a very complicated character. He's probably more like the Val Kilmer character than the Nigel Davenport character.
I just loved all the pot smoking and acid taking, all the stuff Val Kilmer was doing. I mean, that film. And then Frankenheimer ends up directing it, and this old school director comes in, thinks he's going to bark orders and do all this stuff. That had to have been. And they said it went from a 12-week shoot to 6 months.
Yeah, yeah. Well, right? I tell you, we had we watched the 96 version with our former podcast guest, Trish Schwiers. And recently brought her over.
I wanted her to be on this
instead of Deb, but she was too busy.
We talked for hours about this film for through the week. It was like a
with the 96 film.
Yeah, because I think you know she was assistant to the Australian director Bruce Beresford, and the film that Rob Morrow was on before this film was Last Dance, and Trish worked on it and got to know, you know, like Rob Morrow.
So she had all the backstory behind these people that were on this film.
And then when this movie ended, the next
let's just say that Rob Morrow was originally in the David Thewlis role.
And oh, that's right. He didn't see the
for one day, and he was on the tramp steamer with like a puma, and he said, "This is completely insane and out of control. I quit." So that's when
he called the head of the studio. "You don't know me. I'm calling you directly. Get me out of here."
Thing. He was allowed to quit. However, the female actress could not.
Tyra Balk was told, "Your career will be over if you break your contract." And she was very angry and wanted to break
her contract.
She
tried to go to the airport
because
they
fired
the
director,
the
Richard Stanley, 4 days into the shoot. So
So
it was a mess. There's no question. Yeah, it was a mess.
But the other and
good thing it
Trish
didn't affect
has
the movie itself, though. That was.
I mean, John. I mean, yes. Okay, we'll talk about it. I mean,
so
we're
I just
talking
want to say the reason she knows so much is the next big film that came in when Moreau rapped was Paradise Road, which was shot in the same area and had all the same crew. So they were all just sitting there the whole time talking about Moreau. And it was like, she said that, you know, Stanley, it's like when he was running the film, they had no idea what was going on or who was in charge of the movie. But then again, they hated Frankenheimer. So, you know, and it was just, and they hated the actors. You know?
Yeah, if you watch, that's what I'm saying. The doc lays that all out. I mean, it's all in.
But the story itself, it's funny and uncanny that the film itself, in reality, played itself in with the actors. You know what I mean?
They became animals.
It became animalistic. And, you know, it was so impactful for us to watch as voyeurs. You know what I mean? We were movie viewers, but we became really into this theme of animals and humans. You know, what does that mean? And this is why this movie is so powerful today, even if it's 150 years, the concept is 150 years old. You know, it's, wow, it blows your mind. And it leads to future filmmakers great thoughts of a great movie, another Dr. Moreau. And John, I'm curious about your comedy play that you did. Was it, what was it called?
The Crazy Mixed Up Island of Dr. Moreau.
Now, when did this get written?
Oh, I couldn't even tell you. I did it, and I think it was 10th grade. So it's a goofy. I mean, it's funny. It's a really funny play.
Oh my God, I'd love to see that act. You have that film on film?
No.
They didn't even have film when he did it.
Could you do a scene right now?
It's a scene?
No, I did at one point. There was a.
Not with that face.
A seal.
A
girl
sponsor.
Played a seal, and she was all in gray. And there's a big chase scene where we're running back and forth. So I've got her on my back. We run one way, then we run the other way, and I'm on her back. And if you saw this girl, she's like this. So that's what I remember about that.
Has anyone ever seen Tusk?
No.
Kevin Smith's Tusk?
Not yet.
Where he turns what's his name? The
Justin
Apple
Long.
Justin Long into a walrus.
Right.
Yeah, that's a good call for that.
While we were temporarily
off, did you start talking about the 96 version?
We've been talking about it the whole time. Yeah.
Okay, I thought we were starting with the set.
We did.
I'm gonna shock you, perhaps, but I absolutely loved the 96 version.
So did I. There's no shock
it was
there.
Great.
We
need a revival. We need to bring this film back.
I think
Yippee-ki-yay mother
John
podcast
said.
Stamp of approval on this film. I'm sure we'll get tons of.
And you know what was so great about
so exciting.
It was all the stuff that was out of control. Like as soon as Marlon Brando shows up under that cheesecloth, you know, all painted
look on
white
in the Pope mobile.
You know,
right? He was in the Pope mobile.
It's amazing.
And I cracked up. It was so hilarious.
He's on this island. You think about it. He's on this island. He's got like one guy with him, and he's a god. So he can dress up and do anything he wants.
Well, also all the backstory, right? So Bruce Willis was supposed to play the the part that Thews, is that his name?
Thewlis, yeah.
But Demi Moore divorced him, so he couldn't. Val Kilmer's on the island for a week, and he finds out he's getting divorced.
Right.
The French blow up a nuke in the ocean, and it takes out part of Brando's island, his atoll or something that he owned out there. Yeah, and Brando's daughter committed suicide right before this film. So how anybody did anything is beyond. And Frank, poor Frank, and I'm poor. He was probably a total douche. But to him to come in and try to clean this thing up and that they got anything, that they got anything on film and did anything is amazing.
And let's talk about Stanley and his going to a Warlock.
Well, he's
going to a Warlock and affecting Marlon Brando, getting in his head, you know, giving him all this flash and stuff. And then, sure enough, he's back on. He's like maybe going to be back in the movie. But
John, had you seen it when it came out in 90? Did you see it in the theaters?
No, I didn't see it when it first came out.
Where's the hate? The hate is from what?
Look, Brando, you look at Brando and you look at his work and you see that him in that role. It was just depressing to watch. Like even The Freshman that he did later in life, he was so wonderful in The Freshman.
He was great.
Did you see that movie?
Hurrah.
Yeah.
He was wonderful.
Yeah, but
that.
He did with De Niro and Ed Norton.
Yeah,
the one where it was directed by Frank Oz and he got mad at him and said, "Why don't you put your hand up my ass and work me like a Muppet or something?"
He didn't like how I mean, I gotta say, I would not want to work with Brando. But I love the stories of the way Brando just handled his stuff.
But that's
don't
different for,
don't
than
forget
liking
Brando's
the movie.
1997 classic, The Brave.
Different than liking the movie, Ralph. You're talking about everything.
Oh yes, but because of that, I found it. Loved the movie. I loved it. I found that
documentary so engaging.
Yeah,
and I was so invested in the documentary. I found it fascinating. The movie I thought was dumb. It was
how's
Rocky
it dumber
Horror
than
picture show?
Well, I mean, any dumber than the 77?
At least the 77 version, they attempted to take it a lot more serious, a little more grounded, if something like that could be grounded, where the other one was just a bunch.
Well, I'm sure it started out that way. There was going to be a lot more sex in Stanley's version. I think Val Kilmer, that scene he does where he's giving the medicine, he's kissing those beasts on the lips and all that stuff. I mean, there was a lot of weird shit going on in that.
Yeah.
And, to me, it's the weird. Now, Brando, and I was trying to figure this out. There's something about him that catches the eye, not just the size, but...
he's pretty good at acting.
He is pretty good at acting, even when he doesn't care. It's like when he's on the screen, you're watching him. And to me, he defines this movie. And he's not in it that much. I mean, if you count his scenes, you know, he is just...
Well, yeah,
Kilmer is the one who said to the director, "I want to be in this movie 40% less."
And they switched the role.
And they switched the roles, and he played the secondary.
He was
the poor German kid. That
oh
had,
my God,
all this
Marco
stuff
that, Hofschneider, yeah,
who was in Europa. And I'm like, yeah, I remember that.
Yeah.
I remember you, movie. Man. So did
now
you know
the other
story
thing is, you know,
the little guy, he plays Milling, and it was a much bigger role. But Brando became so enamored with the little fella that he essentially gave all those scenes to the little guy, who went to his head at one time. And the German guy's like, when the elevator with him, "Hey, how's it going?" And the guy's like, "F you," and punches him in the testicles, you know. And he's like, "What can I do? I can't fight the small. I can't fight the smallest man on earth."
Now, listen, it's terrible, but it's such a delightful terrible. And Ron Perlman's in there too as another beast. I mean,
well, that's how I look at the movie. Is that there is on so many levels, there's real talent there. It had real Hollywood money, between the people involved and their behavior and the weather. And I mean, they filmed it on Cape Tribulation in the shadows of Mount Sorrow. I mean, what did they think was going to happen? I mean, the set got blown away by a storm, like all this crazy stuff. But it's like this to me, it's a very entertaining, fascinating train wreck before you know the story of what happened, because I saw it in the theater and I didn't know the director got replaced 2 days in. I didn't know who Richard Stanley, well, that's not true. I guess I'd seen Hardware, but I didn't know that Richard Stanley, that this was his dream project, that he had been, you know, dreaming about this and working on this for years. And, you know, when you see the documentary and you imagine how heartbreaking that all was and everything, but
not to mention all the black magic.
Well, he was interviewed on Alec Baldwin's podcast. And he was, which, I mean, you would imagine he should be after the documentary came out anyway, but he was very frank about his experience. And they talked about it for like 15 or 20 minutes. And one thing he said that I thought was really cool, he said that what he wanted to do with that material is not what was done in the movie, of course. And what he wanted to do with the material was really to give the animals a voice about like what would their experience be. They're more than monsters. They didn't choose to be that, and that's why, right, he was so excited to cast people like Marlon Brando and Ron Perlman and all these people who are really great actors. And there's people in that movie that you can't really even recognize under their makeup, like Temuera Morrison, who go on and work for another 30 years in the business and everything. But it's a terrible movie in the best way. I just think it's so fun to watch, and then the technical parts of it, the makeup just astonishes me every time I watch it. I watched it again so that we could talk about this, and I just can't believe how incredibly good it is. And if they were going to make it now with a better production experience, they'd probably use mocap or things like that, and that might be another layer of making it fascinating. But I mean, that to me, to do so much of that in camera when we know what was happening around the camera, literally.
Yeah, I don't know how, like I said,
it's unbelievable.
Yeah,
it's unbelievable.
And the ice bucket on the head, to me.
Oh yeah, all those little moments.
You see that, and she pours.
And the reason why is Marlon Brando was hot.
I know. Listen, guys, and that scene where Val Kilmer impersonates him as he turns around on the chair was so cool. And he asked Brando if he could do that. It was okay for him to do that.
It was a mutual admiration society.
I don't know if they admired each other, but
well, the other thing is about this documentary, you know, it's funny, there are a number of documentaries about movies that were basically impossible to make, and then they got made, and then they're really good, like Apocalypse Now for Hearts of Darkness is that documentary, or Fitzcarraldo, I think it's called Burden of Dreams, about how they made that movie. And this is a documentary about how impossible it was to make this movie and what a disaster it was to make this movie that was also a disaster. I mean, this movie didn't make money. No. This movie didn't get good reviews. This movie isn't the peak of late career Marlon Brando or any of that stuff. And I saw it in the theater and I loved it, but I didn't think it was good. And all these years, I've still thought this isn't good. It's too much of a mess. There's all these weird abrupt cuts from different scenes and how it's all put together. It feels all chopped up and weird and everything. But it is fun and crazy. And the story of Dr. Moreau is a story of madness. And the 1977 version doesn't really catch fire, except for those couple scenes we talked about, like Michael York in the cage. That's actually really intense, and he does a really good job with it. And he already looks like an animal anyway, the same way Fairuza Balk is great casting for that role as well. But I'm glad so many of you think that it was fun, because it is fun.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the 96.
Yeah,
it made the 70s one look dull by comparison.
Stan Winston do the makeup and and Sean, you should. John Chambers, who did the Planet of the Apes makeup, did the makeup for 77.
That explains why it's so much like Planet of the Apes.
Yep. Yeah,
even the music had a slightly Planet of the Apes feel.
Yeah. I like the 77 version. I thought that was all right. Good version. But the 96 just takes the cake for just sheer audacity and fun. I mean,
well, that's a problem. You know, this movie really, Dr. Moreau, the plant. It's just, and the Planet of the Apes really shows you what constitutes, you know, how are we going to feel when we clone human beings now? And so these clone human beings, how are they going to feel without a soul? I mean, if they don't have a soul, and you're married to somebody who has a soul, and you have a child.
Well, we can tell them that.
Yeah, but if you're a clone, you don't know. Well, okay.
No, but here's...
You might feel like you don't, if you don't have a soul. You know, you might notice that.
Well, there's one point I want to make about Richard Stanley and Frankenheimer, how they both were so lucky. Because because Bruce Willis was originally in the cast too. And he is also an actor, particularly late in career, you know, not when he's had the dementia thing, but prior to that, of not listening, not doing what they wanted. Could you imagine having a third lead in this film who just refused to do anything he was told to do? You know,
no, it would have been impossible. I mean, it was bad enough with those two. You know,
Willis looks like he's in a look of horror.
Well, he's never watched the movie.
Yeah, he's never seen it.
He won't watch it.
It was so horrible that
he's an extraordinary actor. So he was an interesting choice to be essentially the hero lead character, audience identification character for this film. This is just a few years after he did what's still probably his greatest role,
Naked?
Which is Naked, the Mike Leigh film. I mean, that's an unbelievable movie, and he is so repugnant and charismatic in that. And in this movie, he's so many different things. And then even when there's a scene that seems to have nothing to do with the rest of the movie, and it looks like it was dropped in and then they just cut back to the rest of the movie, when he's on the boat and he knocks over a crate and then all these little rat creatures attack him and stuff.
Yeah.
What I remember about the scene is his faces and his reaction more than the weird little rat things. I mean, that's the thing. There was so much talent in this movie. And then they made this thing. It's crazy.
Yeah, he was really good. And I bet the directors, both of, well, you know, Stanley didn't have the opportunity to work with them, I guess. But at least you have one guy there doing what, you know, acting and pretending he's in a movie. No.
Okay. Well, frozen again, Sean. Well, 3 out of 4 boxes recommends the 96 version with one.
I understand the fourth box's reaction. I think that's totally fair. Yeah. And had you seen it in the theater with, by the way, a crowd?
Like, well, yeah, I mean, maybe I would have had a different reaction had I seen it with a crowd.
I mean, none of us thought this is the greatest thing I've ever seen, but we all thought, because it just kept showing us these things. And the first time you see the little guy, we're all like, what is happening? What are we watching? And of course, without this version of Dr. Moreau, we wouldn't have Dr. Alphonse Mephisto on South Park, who devotes himself to making animals with four asses. So I recommend that you check that out.
Or Dr. Evil on Mini-Me. Probably wouldn't have had that. Dr. Evil on Mini-Me,
yep. Well, 96, yep. Val Kilmer came off of Batman Forever, 95. Heat, 95. Island. So Val Kilmer, 96, he does this one. He's smack in the middle of his, I mean, Heat. He's smack in the middle of his, you know, stardom. Then he does Dead Girl, which is not the Dead Girl we did on our show.
No.
I think it's a different one.
It is not.
The Ghost in the Darkness. Then he starts slipping a little bit. The Saint, The Prince of Egypt, you know, then it starts getting a little bit. But he's smack in the middle of his
Egypt was a huge hit movie. That was a big hit movie. Yeah.
Is that a film or cartoon?
That was the cartoon.
It's an animated film, Ralph. It's not a cartoon.
I call those cartoons.
That was DreamWorks, wasn't it?
Wasn't that one of their first films.
Okay, wait. Yeah. We got to stop. We got to wait till he comes back. Yep. What is their internet?
This is like the Dr. Moreau production, right?
Oh, yeah, it is. Sorry about that.
There we go. No, it's all right.
We need John Frankenheimer to control this. All right, let's.
No one needs John Frankenheimer.
Sean, are you back? Kind of.
Nope.
Yes.
Well, you're back, but you're still stuttering. Is it your computer or is it your Wi-Fi?
Okay, I was born that. You know what? Our Wi-Fi, you know, of a 6 possible bars is 5 before I hit Zoom, and then it goes to 2.
Oh, really? It dives down to 2. All right. Well, let's wrap this up. So we got, like I said, 3 out of 4 boxes, high rated on the 96 version. You guys are kind of met on the 77 version.
Yeah, it was okay.
Okay. And John, okay. big kudos for the 36. When did that one come out?
32.
All right. Well, let's go to the wheel. We have 3 left.
I pray it's Beauty and the Beast. Beauty and the Beast. Okay. Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah, I need a break.
Beauty and the Beast. You Ralph, you gotta watch them all.
I'm not gonna watch this one. I'm sorry. Oh no! Oh no! Oh no! Oh no! Okay. Okay. So
be
Beauty and
guest,
the Beast.
Be a guest. Mm. Put a service to the test.
Well, which
what are we watching? What are we watching here?
Whose movie is this?
Well, if they can't explain it, we don't have to do it.
The animated one, and then
the live action remake of the animated film.
Yes.
Okay. So the live action remake of the Ron Perlman television series.
Oh,
or the live action remake.
The Linda Hamilton Ron Perlman show.
All right. So
animated Disney film, and then their live action remake. Right.
Not the French version, the original one, which is a brilliant movie.
It is an amazing picture.
All right.
Fascinating from animated films.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Let's do this. Sean, I hate to do this again, but why don't you reboot again? Because we got to do what you watch, and I can't be flipping a three screen.
Oh, geez. I forgot about that. Oh, my God.
Well, make it quick when we do it.
That's the only way to sell you.
All right. Let's go before their internet slows down again.
Okay. Yeah.
The squirrels. Keep those squirrels running. All right, so there we go. Beauty and the Beast. I look forward to taking the week off, but
want to make this the kids episode that we discussed?
If you can get them on, but I'll talk to Chris and see what happens. Okay, may not work out, but we'll see. All right. So let's do a round of what you watch. Make it a flash round, Sean and Debbie, before your internet goes.
Yeah.
I don't remember watching anything this week except
H.G. Wells.
Okay, great. Okay, John.
I pass.
What? All right, Drew, you can. Drew, you take a couple.
So,
Drew.
So I discovered.
Drew, you got 20 minutes.
Because everything on the internet in my house now points me to India. I discovered some clips on YouTube. And this is not a surprise that they've done this, but they've basically made The Office in Hindi.
Out of here.
Yeah, and so I've seen the original British Office, and I've seen the American Office, and they're especially obviously the pilot episode of both, it's the same.
Yeah.
And then so I watched some clips from the pilot episode, and I can't remember their names, but like there's Jim and Dwight having an argument, there's Jim looking at the camera, and the thing that really cracked me up, they had the diversity day training when basically I think in the American one, Steve Carell just antagonizes Oscar so much, making jokes about being Hispanic that he gets slapped. And then it's a quiet pause. And then he's like, great job, everybody. Like, you really did it. Except in this one, it was fun because everybody has to dress up, but they're all dressed up like different pieces of Indian culture. And I was like, oh, I recognize that. That's definitely, that's Bengali or whatever. So it was really bizarre because I didn't speak the language, but I knew everything that they were saying. And then the other thing I did is I watched a movie on Max. It's a sequel. I thought the first one was fine. I watched it because I really liked the cast, and I thought this one was fine, and I liked it because I really watched the cast, called Shazam, Fury of the Gods.
Yeah.
And I imagine if I had a lot emotionally invested in the characters, I would be disappointed. But it was just fun because Zachary Levi is endlessly charming. And the kids that are in the movie are good. And the big superstar cameo at the end is fun. And it's got Helen Mirren and Lucy Liu, all these people in these movies. And they're fun. They're having a good time. So those are the two things that I watched this week, neither of which were super exciting, but I had fun with it. So.
All right. Cool. All right. Well, I finished out Black Mirror, this last season of Black Mirror.
I loved it. Yeah.
Thought it was good. They're a little long, but fun. I love Black Mirror. It's just such a good show.
Oh, yeah.
And then I'm a little late to this one, but I started watching I Think You Should Leave with Tim Robinson. Have you guys caught any of this?
I've seen the first two seasons. It's so funny.
He's an ex-Saturday Night Live writer. He was actually on the show for a year or two, but he's got a skit comedy show on Netflix, which is just outrageously funny.
What's it called?
Called I Think You Should Leave with Tim Robinson.
It's absurd. It's
a skit. It's a sketch comedy show. It's done real quick. They're like 16-minute chunks, maybe 20 minutes at the most. His character's a little hard to take a lot of the times because he does a lot of screaming. But I watched a breakdown of some of the comedy skits, and this guy focused in on the the morals of what his comedy stuff goes for and some of the interesting angles that you take out of these things. And it's a meme worthy. There's a lot of memes out now based on a lot of these skits that he does. One in particular about paying it forward at a takeout window where he pays it forward, then he screeches to the back so he can get in the back to so the guy can pay it. And he orders 55 hamburgers, 55 cheeseburgers, 55. And it's, you know, it's outrageously funny. And he's got all these guest stars that used to be on Saturday Night Live and all this stuff. Fantastic show. And it's digestible because it's in short chunks. And the guy's also a genius.
It's like a real emotional thing in ways that you don't expect. There's an episode where he's in the parking lot and he backs out and he almost hits someone and they screech and the woman he almost hits goes, "What's wrong with you? Don't you know how to drive?" And he goes, No, I don't know how to drive. And then he just plays that and it's so silly and it's so
this
funny.
I'll explain this one that it kind of hit home. It's a bunch of guys playing poker in their basement. And each one of them are giving shit about their ball and chain that they live with. They're all complaining about their wives. And one guy starts complaining. And as he starts complaining, you see him drift off. And then he has this long sequence where it's all these beautiful scenes with his wife and how much they get along. And she supports him and, you know, all this stuff. And he comes back and he just goes, "Look, I can't do this anymore. I can't make fun of my wife. I love my wife." And it's like it takes these turns happen in his shows that are just riotous and there it's I came to it late, but I'm glad I found it because it's fantastic.
Well, I just ordered a pair of pants that have a spot that looks like I peed in them, so
it's I think you should leave with Tim Robinson. It's on Netflix.
So funny.
Yeah, so check it out. All right, their internet crashed, so this is the end of the show. Beauty and the Beast next week, we'll decide whether we bring kids on for it. Based on Sean, and I think Chris's daughter might want to be on as well.
Fucking A.
There you go. Get it out now. And John, anything you want to say to anybody watching the show right now? You pass? Pass.
Subscribe. No, I won't. Subscribe. Hit the notification button and, you know, just try something different. Hit the like button.
Yeah, why not? Why not?
Leave a comment. Something. God almighty. Leave a comment.
Hopefully the episode will have at least 6 likes. Well, 7 likes because of our super fan. So
it better. That's right. It better. All right. All right, guys. Sean and Debbie, get some new internet. Do something. Take a couple more Lyft rides. Buy some new stuff. Who's your provider?
I'll be back in the home studio.
Let's
next
advertise
week,
let's advertise your provider. Who's providing your internet?
Why are we laughing?
Why are we laughing?
It writes itself.
We want to thank our super sponsor, Verizon Wireless.
All right, guys. Have a good week. See you next week.
See ya.
See
ya,
everybody.
Bye.
Have a great week.